Hey everybody, Matt here from Matt's Movies, Music and More, and my special guest Andrew, welcoming you to this week's episode of What Did You Think?
I like that one, that's a good one.
As you may recall from the last episode, if you haven't seen it already, check it out. We talked about, from the drama category, Mud.
Mud.
That never gets old. And
good.
To replace that movie, to replace Mud, we have put on the list the 2013 movie Nebraska.
Okay.
So hopefully that will come up soon.
Yeah.
And to replace the movie that this film has come from, which is the comedy category, we have put in there the 1985 British flick Clockwise.
Okay. Yeah.
You remember that one?
I saw it when I was a boy. Yeah.
The first Python related film there, Monty Python. So hopefully not the last. Yeah. So on to today's movie. So today's movie, as I've said, comes from comedy, and it's a movie that celebrates its 35th anniversary this year, which is Revenge of the Nerds from 1984, directed by Jeff Kanew and starring Robert Carradine, Anthony Edwards, Ted McGinley, and Curtis Armstrong as Booger.
The pivotal role, the Oscar-winning role of Booger.
So, yeah. Revenge of the Nerds, had you seen this before it came up on the Twister Spinner?
No.
Had you any intention of watching it?
No. There's all joking aside, all I knew about it without seeing is that it belonged in that general category of college gross out humour, like Porky's or what's that?
Scribbles, Animal House
sort of thing. So being a bit of a snob, I'm above this sort of thing. I'm never going to touch that. I can tell what kind of movie it's going to be. So when it came up on the Twister Spinner, I did think, oh God, I'm going to have to face this, aren't I? It's going to be stupid. It's going to be sex. And at least it gives me a good excuse to shout and berate Matt for a good half an hour. So
I wasn't looking forward to that. So did it surprise you?
Yes.
In a good way?
In a good way, because it sets itself out very early on as a broad slapstick exaggerated cartoon. It's a screwball teen sex comedy, at least on the surface, but there's a lot more going on with the direction and the characterization than I would have expected, and the script than I would have given credit for with something like this. Yes, it's exaggerated, but it's deliberate and calculated. And we haven't even gotten into the plot or premise yet, which if you want me to...
I'll just throw in a few names here and there, because really Revenge of the Nerds is kind of the story of two friends, Lewis and Gilbert, played by Robert Carradine and Anthony Edwards. And they're friends that have been, they've known each other for years, and they're enrolling at Adams College.
Yeah. So they are going to college. It's nervous, but they're thinking about all the computer science that they'll be able to do. And they're thinking about all the girls there, and think of that number and times that by two, the number of boobs that they're going to have there. So they get there, and very quickly they encounter the Alpha Betas, the jocks, from a distance, but it's enough for them to notice them and go, "Ugh, it's a bunch of nerds!" Obviously, they're in for a rough time, and they even, I think very quickly, get tricked by the, not the Alpha Betas, but the Pies, I want to call them, the cheerleaders.
The Pi Delta Pies.
Okay. They're tricked into a room where they get tarred and feathered, so they've been singled out, but on the plus side, they've got this lovely dormitory that they're staying in. They'll be able to stay in there and work on their course and have a reasonably relaxing time of it. Later that night, the Alpha Betas have a rowdy, drunken party, and part of this is the thing you do with vodka and a fire lighter and go, "Look, I can breathe fire."
The fireball.
Fireball. Oh no, I've breathed onto a curtain. The whole dormitory burns down within like 5 minutes. How did this happen? We don't know how it happened. And from this, they're leader, their patriarchal guardian figure, Coach Harris, I think his name,
played by the great John Goodman.
Goodman says, right then, that dormitory, that freshman dormitory over there, you nerds, get out. Get out. What the alpha betas are staying in your dormitory while this gets repaired. Well, where are we going to stay in? You're going to stay in the gym. And the dean, that even though he's the dean, he's a nerdy dean.
Yeah,
he's a small, bald figure next to this big, imposing coach. So they've got no choice but to stay in there. Mm. And from there, more figures, characters get added to the group, which we'll go into. But they try to quickly get their own dormitory. And even then, they continually face persecution.
Nerd persecution,
and we're not going to let you have any fun or have any liberties.
Yeah.
And when they try to go to the ruling Greek council of the college about it, they find out the leader of the Alpha Betas is the head of the Greek council, so void.
Yeah.
You're not getting a say. we were broken into. We don't care. So that gradually it becomes, well, look at the title of the movie.
Yeah.
We're going to have to do something about this. We're going to have to get our own back using our certain set of skills.
Kind of like Liam Neeson a little bit. Although we can't mention him at this moment in time.
They're moving swiftly on.
Yeah, but hearing the title Revenge of the Nerds, I assume in the 80s, if you didn't see the poster, would you assume that this could be a horror movie with a title like that?
What, Revenge?
Yeah, with Revenge. Because, I mean, Star Wars' original title for Return of the Jedi was Revenge of the Jedi. So straight away, that could have been a bit...
It's funny you mentioned that, because I heard that this was conceived as a low-budget write-off of all the gazillion profits that 20th Century Fox made out of Revenge of the Nerd, Return of the Jedi.
Oh, okay. That's interesting to know. I didn't know that. Okay.
Well. I'm mangling up the words here, but it was so conceived as we can do this. We can shoot at some college. We can let the director get on with whatever he wants to make. And oh boy, did the director do what he wanted to make. Because with him, and I think this was created from a place of personal persecution and bullying that he went through in college, or so I've read. But not only that, but with the characters and the actors, this group, this team, came up with all sorts of dialogue and what they wear. So that throughout this movie, there's a very spontaneous energy, this creative enthusiasm and energy from the actors, which, you know, goes a long way to making it feel like a fun time.
Yeah, and it kind of feels like the movie's kind of done over the case of one college year, right?
And I imagine that's how these movies usually play out.
Yeah, because really what you've got is you've got the story of Lewis and Gilbert, which is that, you know, they've gone to the college and now that they've been kicked out thanks to the Alpha Betas, led by Stan Gable, isn't it? Stan Gable, played by the great Ted McGinley.
Because the name sounds like Clark Gable, so there's your...
And his girlfriend, who's Betty Childs, played by... her name is Julie Montgomery. And she becomes someone that Lewis he's kind of madly in love with her from a distance. And basically what happens is, as Lewis and Gilbert are kicked into the gym where all the nerds are going to stay, they make friends with other nerds, including Dudley Dawson, a.k.a. Booger, played by Curtis Armstrong. What do you think of Booger? Because to me, he doesn't seem like a nerd. He just seems more like a slob.
I've heard in the scripting phase that he was a biker or something, but otherwise I do take your point. Of all the nerds on here, it feels like you don't... The only reason you belong with this group is that you're an outsider because you're gross and disgusting.
Yeah, because you've got him, you've got Poindexter. Now, fair enough, Poindexter looks like a nerd. You've got Wormser, who's like a 12, 13, 14-year-old kid who's been enrolled to the college because he's so smart. You've got then Lamar.
I found his opening line is something like, I feel like a refugee from a war camp or something. Again, persecution, discrimination, which I think we'll get into.
Yeah. And then you've got Lamar, who is this gay, effeminate man. He's not a nerd, he's just gay.
No, but he's an outsider that gets picked on.
Okay, so, and then you've got Takashi, the token Japanese?
Token Japanese, polite and gullible Japanese student. And I think that would, I've heard that was an improvised touch with the card games that he plays with Booger. I've got four kings. Is that good? No, that's not
good. Too many
good.
Kings.
No, that's not good. You have to take these out. You have to get these. There, that's a better deck now. Oh, look, I've won. I've beaten you.
Yeah.
Again.
Yeah.
I'm no good at this.
Yeah. But because they're so desperate to get a new place to live, the story is that they, before they can even get a new place to live, they have to be part of a fraternity. And the only way they can get a fraternity is by being accepted by a fraternity and then the Greek council approving it.
Yeah.
So the only people that will take them, and it's only because of a tri-law small print.
With this small print, you have to accept us for 60 days. Oh, all right then.
It's Lambda Lambda Lambda, which is primarily a black fraternity. So it's the only fraternity that will take them against the wishes of the the leader of the Lambda Lambda Lambda, UM Jefferson, played by the late Bernie Casey. It's interesting because you have this scene where they have a party, and their party is going really well. They're trying hard to impress UN Jefferson and stuff like that. And they invite some girls, and the girls they invite are these kind of nerd, kind of from the other fraternity that they pally up with, who are the Omega Moos.
Yeah.
And obviously during that time, Lewis gets laid, and you know everyone's having a fun time at a party. And all of a sudden, the Alphas and the Pies, they ruin the party. And so UN Jefferson sees from a distance that, hang on a minute, this is totally wrong. This is not fair at all. And they're just trying to ruin everything that they do. So the nerds decide to come up with their revenge tactic.
The first revenge, yeah. Their first direct action.
Yeah, and that is to set up cameras in the Pies fraternity houses.
How are they able to set up the cameras?
Yeah, they sneak
how are,
in.
How are they able to get the footage?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, so if you have to count it as sex comedy tropes, this is probably the one scene in the movie where it counts as a sex comedy because of the nudity that's used in it here, and a lot of it for gratuitous reasons.
Well, there's a couple more later in the movie, but...
Yeah, but this is sort of the primary scene, and with the Mission Impossible music playing in the background, it makes it look exciting.
Yeah, that was a great... joke,
yeah,
a great visual sickness, exaggerated visual and audio signifier, yeah.
Mm. But then there's also other little revenges, isn't there? Such as like Takashi is the guy who is collecting the jock straps from the Alpha Betas after they've finished their practice match, and so what they decide to do is get all the jock straps and put some sort of like liquid heat thing in them so that when they eventually put them on, they're going to start grabbing their balls and going, ah! And everything like that. And that's really funny. And then it sort of culminates with them having this Greek games, the homecoming games ceremony.
Yeah.
And that's a lot of fun, isn't
it? They find ways to surpass or get one up on the Alpha Betas. They especially built javelin
which wobbles.
And Chariots of Fire is playing. A version of Chariots of Fire is playing.
And then there's like the scene when Takashi is driving the little go-karts because they're doing he's riding a like a tricycle, and they have to chug a beer every time they do a lap. But they're giving Takashi some sort of pill, so it means that he won't get drunk.
Oh, and the blind one among them pokes it in Takashi's eye or comes close to doing
so in that. Theory, aren't they cheating, the nerds, on that one?
Yeah, but nobody's noticing.
And then you got Eat a Pie for Charity, which is hilarious.
Eat the pie, and there's a female type of pie, and
picture of Betty naked and stuff, and Stan and the other Alpha Betas are trying to work out, like, the nerds are outselling us on pies over the kissing booth that we're running, and They work it out, and then when Stan Gable goes to look at the pies after, it's just whipped cream.
It's whipped cream, and you wipe away the whipped cream, and you see what's underneath.
And he's like, "That's my pie." And it's just so funny. And then obviously you've got other bits like the song and dance number, which really stands out. I really like that.
Yeah.
And obviously then it culminates with the final act of the movie, without spoiling too much, but it's kind of this stand up for nerd rights.
I kind of appreciate that both the fact that this movie goes at a pretty efficiently condensed pace. I'm pretty sure this was practiced back in the 80s, but they don't linger on certain scenes too long. And more to the point here, they don't have too many speeches about we're being persecuted, this is not fair. You don't get to the real message of the movie until that final scene, which I do applaud. You kept the jokes going. You kept the fun and the humour and the stereotypes and these outrageous situations going, and you only brought in the dramatic meat of this screwball teen sex comedy when necessary.
Yeah, because, I mean, I don't know if you want to continue on with the rest of the plot, but I kind of like the interaction that final scene has with Dean Ulick and Coach Harris, in which he eventually decides to stand up himself.
It's a resolution to all those times that Coach Harris has been putting him down or being physically intimidating. Yeah,
yeah, because he's like, "Let that boy go," and he's like, "What'd you say?" He goes, "You heard me, let him go." He goes, "So what if I do?" He goes, "Says me, you asshole."
Yeah, I'm the dean. Yeah, finally asserts his authority.
But regarding this movie, I think this is a great ensemble cast of actors that they've used for playing the nerds and the alpha betas. But you look at them and there's a lot of good character costumes and the way they've made the characters look, because none of them look like nerds in real life. None of them. No. They're all pretty good looking people anyways. And I remember there was a joke made about it in the 2000 movie American Splendor, which has got Paul Giamatti. One of the main characters in that film wanted to go and see Revenge of the Nerds, and then the Paul Giamatti character, who's based on, is it Harvey Crumb or something like that, the comic book animator, he says something along the lines of, "They're not nerds, they're just good-looking people dressed to pretend to be a fictional nerd." But
which is a reference to this.
Yeah. But with the movie, I mean, the actors involved, I mean, Robert Carradine, great actor anyways. Anthony Edwards, I mean, this was one of his early movies. I mean, he would work with Jeff Kanew, actually in 1985, on Gotcha, which was the next movie that he did. And then, obviously, a year later, he'd go on to do Top Gun. And then it would be like, whoa, his career's going in this direction. And then you've got people like Curtis Armstrong, who, in 1987, he actually worked with Bruce Willis and Cybill Shepherd on the TV series Moonlighting. Mm. So straight away, this was a big deal for him. Going on to Brian Toshi, who plays Takashi. He was in the Police Academy sequel. And then on to the Alpha Betas. So these Alpha Betas, I want to mention these three, because these, I think, are really good actors, these three.
Yeah.
Ted McGinley, who plays Stan Gable. He's kind of the baddie that you want to love. You don't really want to hate him.
You know he's a baddie at one point because he's wearing Darth Vader's costume,
which comes into play in the big scene.
Yeah.
Ted McGinley would be famous for being in Happy Days, and then later on would be cast in his most famous role, which is in Married with Children. I don't know if you ever saw that at all, but he was in that. Matt Salinger, who plays Burke, this is who I really want to mention. Matt Salinger, do you know that he is a relation of Catcher in the Rye author J.D. Salinger?
Oh, yeah, now you mentioned the surname. Yeah.
And do you also know that was also Captain America in the 1990 Captain America movie?
Oh, God, that film.
Yes. So,
can you stop the car? I think I'm going to be sick. All right, so you're...
Yeah, yeah.
That was Captain America's power in that movie.
Hopefully we'll cover that at some point.
To trick hitchhikers. Yeah, I'm going off topic, sorry.
Okay. And then you've got Donald Gibb, who plays Ogre. Now, Ogre is kind of the Alpha Beta's opposite of Booger. Hence why there's a line where they do the belching competition, which is like...
Yeah, that's his big shining moment to be the counterpoint to, yeah.
Yeah, because he's like, Frederick Polowatsky, booger. He's like, booger, okay, booger, that's who you are. And he's like, Dudley Dawson. He's like, call me booger. And he's like, booger, okay. So then ogre versus booger in this burping and stuff like that. But Donald Gibb was actually in the Jean-Claude Van Damme movie, Bloodsport. So I don't know if you've seen that at all, but he's in that. And with some of the authority figures in this, the three main authority figures, you have John Goodman, as we said, plays Coach Harris. This must have been one of his early roles before he did Roseanne and stuff like that. And Bernie Casey, who does Ewan Jefferson, he was in like all these blaxploitation movies. But the one that must surprise you is Lewis's father, Mr. Skolnick, who is played by James Cromwell.
Well, don't you mean Jamie Cromwell, in the like it says in the credits?
Jamie Cromwell.
I did have to do a double take at that and see him on screen. That's him.
Yeah, it's him. He's mostly remembered to you lot out there as the farmer in Babe, and also in L.A. Confidential and iRobot, lots of other great movies.
And Zephram Cochrane.
Yes.
I get it.
But so with Revenge of the Nerds, did you know that there was three additional sequels made to this as well?
I've seen them on like a Blockbuster video DVD video shelf back in the day.
Yeah, because Revenge of the Nerds 2 came out in 1987, which is called Nerds in Paradise, and Anthony Edwards, because he had just done Top Gun, was quite a big star then. He was kind of in it like a Obi-Wan Kenobi kind of presence. They sort of did that sort of Star Wars parody of that.
Oh, right.
And then obviously the 3 and 4 were made for television, which is 3 is The Next Generation, came out in 1993. Great title.
Oh, and fine.
And 1994's Nerds in Love, which did reunite many of these actors. Jamie Cromwell was in that one. But they got a different actor playing the Anthony Edwards part, although the guy did kind of look like him, but a lot fatter. So with Revenge of the Nerds, cost between $6 and $7 million to make, made over $60 million in America, mostly through home video, I would say.
Yeah, again, one of those apocryphal stories that I've seen on the internet. So correct me if I'm getting this wrong, but I think the executive that was supposed to be in charge of the cinematic release of this movie was like, this is stupid, this isn't going to make any money, and deliberately didn't release it in as many cinemas as possible. Then he got in hot water from the studio because they were queuing up outside, you know, what precious few cinemas were showing it, and it would have arguably made a lot more money. It made money, like you say, on home video cult release afterwards, but it would have done much better because people were actually attracted to this. So this executive going, nerds don't sell money, you know, got his comeuppance, you know, given the context of this movie. How's that for dramatic irony?
But with Revenge of the Nerds, I mean, you look at it and you just think to yourself, thinking, well, it's marketed as a sex comedy, fair enough, but it's not like any of those other sex comedies, I'd say. I think it's got more heart to it.
Yeah, there's more thought and care put into things like the jokes and the costumes and the characters here. Yes, they are stereotypes, but they go for it. That even with like the font in the credits, the computery nerd font in the credits, and the synthy music that goes with the nerds in comparison to, I don't know, more traditional music that plays whenever other characters like the jocks are on screen.
That's something I want to say, actually, because I suggested this for Matt's Movie Music and More, as you can probably tell me throwing in a lot of facts there. I'm a huge fan of Revenge of the Nerds, and I saw it probably in the late 1990s, and I bought the DVDs of them when they came out, and one of the things I bought relating to it is the soundtrack. I just think the music, which is, it's not the coincidental music, which is done by Thomas Newman, but the actual pop songs that are in this movie, there's some really good stuff on there. Although, did you know that on the soundtrack, you probably aren't aware of this.
No, do enlighten us.
You have Talking Heads' Burning Down the House, which is used during the jocks burning up the house.
Oh, no.
Yeah. That song. You have Michael Jackson's Thriller, which is used in the party scene. And at the very, very end, Queen's We Are the Champions. All three of those songs don't feature on the soundtrack of the CD.
Because copyright.
Yes, instead you've got other songs such as the brilliant 80s montage song One Foot in Front of the Other, which they actually use in Ted 2. If you've seen Ted 2, they actually use that song in a montage there. And you've got songs like Gleaming Spires, Are You Ready for the Sex Girls, which was used actually in 1982's The Last American Virgin.
No.
And they also composed another song as well for the film. But I think the soundtrack's great. I think they did a really good job with that. I think the movie is very underrated, personally, in my opinion. It's one of those comedies that I can watch over and over and over again and enjoy it every time.
One more point I want to bring up before my own closing thoughts. Is it worth bringing up the elephant in the room? And I'm talking about women here.
Okay, enlighten us.
Various things I could do. The whole peeping, perving with the camera thing. The whole Omega Muse and what's his name when he wants to kiss Betty at the carnival?
Lewis.
He goes to Lewis and he goes, "No, I'm not kissing a nerd." And so Gable goes, "Yeah, kiss this nerd."
Yeah.
You get it? It's funny because she's ugly and fat.
Yes.
Ha 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 ha. But that's not the worst of it.
No
the worst of it is Lewis gets the Darth Vader costume and goes into the tent. So Betty obviously thinks, "Oh, it's you," and they have sex. They get down and dirty, and it's not until after they've done it that the helmet's taken off. "You're not Stan. You're the nerd." And her reaction is to go, "Wow. I didn't know nerds were that good at sex." That's a woman's reaction to effectively being date raped. I'm sorry to bring this up, but in today's world, that would be the camera and this incident would be grounds for prosecution. Then again, what can we say? The focus of the film is the discrimination and the fight back and the emancipation of the nerds, and how this is reflected, you know, how the Lander see this and see a parallel with their own upbringing. But okay, fine. Mm. And it's about the nerds of what they suffer, what they go through, and their ultimate triumph. And it's not a brilliant answer, and I do apologize, but what can we say? It was a product of its time. I mean, I don't know if you have any.
Do you think that Fox would have released this not expecting it to be the hit that it was? Maybe had it not been the case, we wouldn't be talking about it now. Because did you say it was something to do with like a tax write-off?
That's what I saw on the internet, that it was based on the enormous profits that they made off Return of the Jedi, that they had enough money to make this inconsequential teen sex screwball comedy thing.
But the thing is, those 80s sex comedies anyways were very successful. Even the low budget things like Screwballs and stuff like that. After seeing the success of Porky's, any film studio could have made a movie like that, which they did, and they made money because of home video. So this film clearly had an audience, which was home video. And that's why it warranted the sequel, I guess. But after seeing this, could you see yourself ever watching the sequels?
I'm sorry to be shallow. I'll say first that, especially after the way you've described that the direction that they went in, straight to video and the next generation and nerds in love, I'm not in any great hurry to do that. But
well, Robert Carradine was in all four of them as Lewis. Gilbert, the Anthony Edwards character, he wasn't in it, only in like one and a bit of two, and not even him, but his character was in number four. Yeah. So for continuity of the characters, there were a few changes here and there.
And I will say that having shown my prejudiced disdain for the idea of seeing the sequels that I am glad that I was forced to watch this because so the
beginning. You make that sound so bad.
The beginning didn't give me much hope with these two guys and their dad talking, thinking about boobs and computers and their. I can't repeat it. I thought, oh, help me. The entire movie is going to be like this, isn't it?
Yeah, but then that's a stereotype of nerds because nerds don't do that.
But then when I sort of saw the jocks and the over-the-top events that happened, like the burning down of the dormitory and we're shoving you in the gym and being introduced to these other characters that I thought, oh, thank goodness it's not going to be just those two brothers or what threat you say it's friends.
Yeah.
That I started to warm more towards a little, and the more that these outrageous stereotypes that these characters and their interaction and the so over the top jokes that you can't help but go, this is ridiculous, and this is a fun and silly kind of ridiculous that I was able to go along with it.
Yeah, because obviously with Lewis is kind of the confident nerd. He's the one that's like, we're going to college and we're going to meet women and we're going to have a good time. Whereas Gilbert's like, well, I don't know, Lewis, I'm feeling a bit nervous. And then as the movie goes on, the personalities kind of change, that Lewis becomes a bit more afraid and Gilbert becomes more prepared to stand up, hence why with the ending and stuff.
Yeah.
But
The script is... It's about sex and nerds and bullying and triumphing at college, but it's more nuanced. It's more developed than you would give it credit for.
Yeah,
and the performances, the chemistry between the ensemble cast is what really makes this movie work.
Yeah, the fact that they're probably all unknowns at the time probably helped a lot.
Yeah.
And hence why it was probably able to make this film on such a cheap budget.
Yeah.
But I'm really glad that we covered this film on the channel, and I'm glad that you actually got a surprise, that you actually enjoyed it.
A pleasant surprise.
Okay, so that's any more you want to sum up?
I think that's it.
Cool, so that's Revenge of the Nerds. Yeah, twist the spinner time. So let's see if it will pick something more interesting this week. So without further ado, let's spin that wheel. So it's landed on Thriller. Yeah, after what it being in the movie. Clever. But careful, copyright protection there.
Just saying it.
Yeah, just saying it.
Oh, come on.
Well.
I give up.
No, I don't.
Well, as it's Thriller, the movie that's come up for Thriller is End of Watch.
Okay.
Jake Gyllenhaal and Michael Peña.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you know much about it?
I'm sure I keep saying this. I was aware of it when it came out. I'm pretty sure I even saw the trailer for it and saw its unique presentation. But no, I haven't actually sat down and watched it.
Well, I'm looking forward to checking it out, definitely. So thanks, Andrew. And thank you, everybody out there, for watching. What did you think of Revenge of the Nerds? Did you enjoy it? I mean, did you enjoy it at Andrew's level or did you enjoy it at my level? A lot more excitable.
Yeah, I do.
And check out, we've got on the channel, we've got At the Movies with Andrew, which is his series about the new films that are coming out in cinema, if you want to find out anything good on that. We've got What Did You Think, which we do here. We've got my solo videos. If you go into the descriptions and the likes and the describing, we've got Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, all of that. Message us. Keep in contact. We want to hear from you. Come up with some titles that maybe you can suggest to us.
Not Twilight.
Would you agree?
Careful what you wish for.
Well, anyway, thank you very much, guys. And for our closing statement, what are we going to do?
No!
Goodbye, everybody.